咁我哋依家會開始嘅中文發言，同埋唔好意思咁樣同我哋咁講，就係闖住通知大家，但係時太緊迫，唔好意思。
咁我哋中文發言，我而家會開始答。反修例示威踏入第四個月，港共政權對住200萬人聲音仍然充耳不聞，反而用警暴、白色恐怖想消滅民意，用假撤回、假對話、假新聞去離間香港人。可幸的是，香港人秉持著不分化、不割席、不篤灰的原則，堅守信念，對民主自由的追求毫不動搖。10月1日，許政權企圖謀殺學生之後，非但止不追究殺性而起的魔警，更用盡方法想要謀殺香港一整代人，企圖用行政命令繞過立法機關，頒布緊急法，制定反蒙面法。但是勇敢的香港人將會無視這條蒙面惡法，因為現在踢拖落街、穿黑衫路過都已經有被控暴動罪的風險，用惡法阻嚇香港人是行不通的。同一時間，警察每日蒙面使用致命暴力，真槍實彈對待市民，前線警員情緒失控，濫用暴力見怪不怪，但是仍然沒有依照警察通例佩戴委任證和展示其警員編號，令市民投訴無門。法律面前人人平等，警察為何不以身作則？身為執法者有法不依，何以執法？政權聽住，每當政極權政府不使反蒙面法，均以流血革命告終。在2014年1月16日，烏克蘭政府為了壓制抗爭通過反示威法，當中就包括禁止發售頭盔和禁止蒙面，但相關的舉動並無嚇怕人民繼續抗爭，反而激起更加多人用各種方式反抗，最終結果是政府倒台，警方遭清算追究並需要致歉。2015年，南韓總統朴槿惠在內閣會議入面表示，禁止立法民眾蒙面參與遊行，以便警方逮捕暴徒。結果有40000民眾蒙面上街示威抗議，控訴政府妨礙集會自由，而朴槿惠政權最後也不得善終。特區政府如果今日斗膽立反蒙面法，就證明真係想搞革命、想攬炒、想令香港危足深陷、萬劫不復的，正正是林鄭月娥同埋佢背後的中共政權。保皇黨聲稱有歐美國家同樣反蒙面法，但重點在於呢啲國家都是民主國家，呢啲國家反蒙面是人民自己的選擇。保皇黨居然用專制獨裁的中共和特區政府相提並論，可笑至極。另一方面，早前大律師吳凱兒、李柱銘已分別質疑緊急法立法並無足夠的法理基礎，基本法第27、第28條保障香港人的人身自由，亦列明了香港人集會結社、示威遊行的權利。更重要的是，根據基本法的43條，香港特別行政區的立法權力是屬於香港立法會而非政府。幾年來，立法會已經被政府用 DQ 手段削弱退平，現在林鄭更加進一步跨過立法程序，立法、執法、司法通通由港共包辦，三權分立，名存實亡，法治社會將會土崩瓦解。緊急法這個先例一開，後患無窮。反蒙面之後就可以進一步立國歌法、立獄警法、行宵禁令、查封傳媒以至沒收資產、禁用通訊軟件及互聯網，最後就會鎖港。在緊急法下面，今日政府可以反蒙面，明天亦都可以沒收各位的所有資產。香港是國際金融中心的基石，在於完善的法治制度和對私有產權有充分的保障，加上高透明度的政策，減低投資風險。早前國際評級機構惠譽下調本港的評級及展望，並表明近期的事件令國際對香港管治制度、法治質素和效率有負面的看法，造成長期的損害，並且質疑了營商環境的穩定性。投行高盛亦都估計近月已經有港幣300億的資金流入了新加坡，如果緊急法一出，等於進一步確認港共為獨裁政權， 擾亂法治並為本港製造緊張狀態。香港人引以為傲的法治體系亦都即將作廢，國際金融中心的地位亦將宣告死亡。各國企業或者需要審視是否真的需要撤資，經濟一定會有大影響。五大訴求包括普選、特赦在內，每個訴求都是建基於基本法的框架上面。相反，政府一而再、再而三違反基本法，無視基本法賦予市民的權利。一國兩制、港人治港、高度自治，這個是香港人最卑微的要求，是基本法賦予香港人的權利。一路走來，當政權都從來沒有尊重過兩制，怎樣要求市民尊重一國？請大家記住，緊急立法之日就是一國兩制真正敗亡之時，就是不分黃藍全體攬炒的 end game。 我們再次呼籲國際社會正視一國兩制已經完全失敗這個事實，並懇切呼籲國際關注人道主義的組織可以伸出援手，從人道危機解救以血肉之軀爭取民主自由的香港抗爭者。香港人無懼惡法，誓死頑抗。 If you burn, you burn with us。
Hong Kong has been greatly rewarded with political unrest for the fourth month since the introduction of the Equal Attribution Bill. Instead of addressing the five demands raised so clearly by more than 2 million citizens, the tyrant has chosen to oppress the own people with the police brutality and white terror. Despite international uproar,the government has shamelessly chosen to deceive the world with half-hearted dialogue and a fake withdrawal. Our supposedly dignified official figure has even stood as low as releasing fake news, misleading its own people and blatantly lying about its inhumanity with the single goal of dividing its own community, turning its own blood and flesh against each other. Fortunately, the collective wisdom of Hong Kongers means we have firmly adopted the principle of no diversion, no division, and no denunciation. Despite the government's desperate attempts to divide and conquer, we will always remain fully united in our common quest for democracy and freedom. On the 1st of October, the National Day of Mourning, an 18-year-old schoolboy was shot in the chest by a member of a state-sponsored terrorist organization called the Hong Kong Police Force. This young schoolboy was far from being the only victim. What we are seeing today is the government choosing to wipe out a whole generation of Hong Kongers. The Hong Kongers are definitely brave, so this pathetic government can rest assured that their anti-mask law will disobey with full passion. Why? Because we have nothing else to lose in a city where going downtown for a bowl of noodles in our flip flop and wearing black can be an invitation for arrest. We have nothing left to lose. We have never been able to file any complaints when the police go around without their warrant card and with their ID numbers covered up. And when they hide behind their own mask to kill civilians every day, if equality before the law still exists, why does the government not make this so-called law enforcement reveal themselves first? History repeats itself. History repeats itself. Anti-mask law in the past have only caused more bloodshed in the midst of revolution. We would like to remind the Hong Kong government to remember the story from Ukraine. The government also tried to impose an anti-mask law to stem our protests. And what was the result? The law was ironically united its own people and even more defiantly against the government. The law that banned helmets and masks can do nothing to terrorize its people. Instead, it's only served to fuel the already raging fire of revolution against the brutal totalitarian regime. Not only did the law topple the totalitarian government, the heartless and merciless perpetrators who were part of bringing about terror and injustice were tried and purged. Apology at this point were less than words, taken merely as a desperate attempt to salvage whatever dignity and chance of life the guilty had. South Korea, prior to its democratization, tell a similar tale. We are not threatening by the Hong Kong government, but the tide of history is
should the Hong Kong government be naive enough to gamble away its already crippling rule of an anti-mask law, this will backfire and accelerate its downfall. A true revolution before Hong Kong and all, as history has repeatedly proven, would be lost. If anyone this unmarked strikes, may history remember the couples were Carrie Lam, the government and the CCP's heinous crimes against humanity. The pro-establishment defenders of the government claim that the anti-mask law also exists in some Western countries, naively ignoring the fact that all these countries are democratic societies in which citizens enjoy the right to choose their own representative by fair suffrage, and laws are made through democratic systems. In other words, the anti-mask law in this country exists out of the citizens' own choice. It's absurd to compare the rule of dictatorship under the Chinese Communist Party and the Hong Kong government with democratic choices in the civilized Western world. On the other hand, Barrister Martin Lee Chuming and Margaret Hoi Yi questioned earlier the legitimacy of invoking emergency regulation ordinance, claiming that the lack of prudential justification rendered the invocation of unconstitutional. Article 27 and 28 of Hong Kong Basic Law safeguard the freedom of Hong Kong residents, and the mark ban is listed, and I quote, the freedom of association, of assembly, of procession, and of demonstration. That's it. More importantly, the Hong Kong government plans to make regulation based on emergency regulation ordinance. This, again, is unconstitutional. According to the Article 73 of the Basic Law, the right to enact laws belong to the Legislative Council. In the past few years, the Hong Kong government has already ducked election candidates. What Carrie Lam is doing is now further deliberating the Legislative Council, overriding the proper procedures of lawmaking, and implementing the so-called rule of law with Chinese characteristics, thereby extraditing and mutilating the core values of Hong Kong's judicial independence. Since this government claims so shamelessly to uphold the law, we dare them to answer this question of constitutional law. What kind of solid jurisprudential support do you have to justify the bulldozing all over the Legislative Council and raping basic law? The government could well be tearing, the government could well just be tearing our masks off face today. The law might come tomorrow could be the Cultural Revolution style confiscation of your assets and property. The watertight legal system of globalized finance center. We have, since the onset of the movement, been downgraded in terms of our economic system. We only established the Hong Kong Chinese government as a totalitarian regime more surely. The violation of our rule of law has already created economic turmoil for Hong Kong. Many of our foreign investors are already considering retreat. Thanks to this government, our legal system will soon be burned to ashes. Hong Kong status as an international financial center will be soon obliterated to death. The five demands, including universal suffrage and grant of amnesty, are all within the constitutional framework of basic law. The government, on the other hand, has time and again violated the basic law and disregarded the rights promised in our current constitution. On 1st of July, protesters tore the basic floor into pieces, not to show disrespect towards this constitutional document, but to mock the government's disregard for its sins the 1st of July of 1997. One country, two systems. Hong Kong people ruling Hong Kong, a high degree of autonomy, these are the humblest of demands on the lips of us Hong Kongers. When the governing power has never respected two systems, what right does it have to demand that citizens respect one country? Today, emergency law is declared as a dying day of the one country, two system principle. Those who monitor and review the status of autonomy in Hong Kong from foreign countries will understand what this implies, a true end game. Would hereby like to make an urgent appeal to humanitarian organizations in the international community to lend a helping hand to Hong Kong. Please come to us with as much as humanitarian aid as possible, and as soon as possible. Hong Kong has nothing but our bare flesh against this blasting guns and riot gear of this tyranny. This tyranny wants to kill every single one of us. We are making this desperate appeal to you. for we have exhausted all other options and we are dying out. Even in the face of this evil law, Hong Kong will never bow down or give in. If this government wants us all to burn, we'll make sure this government burns with us. If we are taking a trip down to hell, we shall make sure that our government comes along and stays there. Thank you.
好啦，咁依家到到記者發問環節，啊邊位記者想發問？有記者想發問？
其實已經是完全不追究魔性而起 的魔警，而是反而去打壓市民的自由。我深信在他這個這樣的行為底下，市民只會越來越憤怒，越來越願意自發去提出更多行動。
原來我想補充一點，林鄭在上一兩個星期就提出對話，而對話的結果就是立紅變法，咁呢個係咪佢所謂嘅對話呢？我相信大部分嘅示威者係並不畏懼呢個蒙面法。當一個普通市民都可以被拉，當著黑衫嘅人都可以被拉嘅時候，但你仍然但你仍然見到無數嘅人係出嚟繼續抵抗，而所謂嘅學生被告暴動，就算佢冇做乜，唔係做咗啲乜嘢行為時候，都被告暴動。咁蒙面法係何足掛齒呢？我相信並會影響到呢班人。另外，我並不否認有一小部分嘅人係會畏懼呢個政權，但請你哋記住，記得我哋行呢四個月行過嘅路，由6月9日100萬人、200萬人，到到警察射傷、射盲記者同埋市民嘅眼，到到琴日，到到前日係開槍。所謂的最低武力去意圖謀殺我們的抗爭者，而個抗爭者只是用一個普通 的棍都不如的武器去打落去，那是一個適當的武力呢？所以如果你們害怕的時候，請想回這幾個月走的行動，我相信之後一路的路程在你們之前見到的人一樣會繼續跟你們出來繼續抗爭，所以並不要害怕，請大家繼續出來。
咁我哋今次民間記者會就再次結束，多謝大家支持。